Today, we're gonna peruse the Steam Hardware Survey Graphics Card Hall of Fame. Then we're gonna take the last four champions, throw them on the deck of a ship in international waters, and then drop a knife in the middle of the room to see what happens. But before we get to that, today's video is sponsored by Be Quiet and their majestic new case, the Lightbase 600LX. And all you need to know about the 600LX is instead of a bunch of floppy pins for the front panel, it uses a solid connector, which in itself makes so this case S tier. Now, of course, there are other things like huge radiator compatibility. You can use it in upright and lying down configuration, and it comes with four Lightwing LX fans, but mainly that front panel connector thing. So get your own bodacious Lightbase 600LX using the link down below. Now for our Steam Graphics Card Hall of Fame retrospective, we're going to look at one graphics card at a time, starting with the newest entry, and then reach back into the annals of history. Which interestingly, while doing research for this video, I ran into a bit of a problem. Apparently, Steam doesn't just let plebs like us access its historic data. So to see what the previous most popular graphics cards were, we had to do some internet magic research. But we'll go into more detail on that a little bit later, because for the first graphics card, we don't have to do that. We just look at the Steam Hardware Survey and see that it's the RTX 3060, which has been at the top of the Steam Hardware Survey pile since August of 22. That's more than 2 years. That's pretty impressive, especially when we get further back in history, things get real convoluted pretty quickly. On paper, the 3060 is a reasonable card. We get 12 gigs of video memory, which isn't a given for a lot of modern NVIDIA graphics cards, and we even get ray tracing cores. Although, 28 actually isn't a tasty amount of ray tracing cores. You can't do a whole lot of ray tracing with it, but it's the thought that counts, I guess. On a quick side note, apparently there's also an 8 gig version of the RTX 3060, which I didn't know before researching this video, so make sure to not accidentally buy one of those. Anyway, with that, let's see how the 3060 performs. Now, of course, we're starting off with CS2 at 1080p low settings because this represents esports titles, which is the games that, like, most people play. And here, the 3060 is running the crap out of this game, which is not surprising. It's very easy to run. But this is at 1080p, so let's see what happens when we push it up to 1440p. Ah yes, we're still getting many of the frames, about as much as you could want. But even at a higher resolution, CS2 really isn't that demanding, so let's crank things up a bit. Here, I'm running a 1080p high, which I'm not entirely sure how I feel about, because it's going to do some real devastation to the other graphics cards in this list. But with the 3060, we're getting a lot of frame rate. Look at that. We're well over 120 frames per second. So if you wanted to push the settings even higher, you can easily do that. Or you could also get more performance by subscribing to the channel to get it to 700,000 subs. Ooh. Like here, for example, where I'm running at 1440p and we're still at about 120 frames per second. Now, Doom Eternal is a very well-optimized game. It's one of the reasons why I use it. So I am curious to see how the 3060 holds up to games based on the game engine equivalent of that ape from Sekiro. But all in due time. First, let's try another classic. Now with Cyberpunk at 1080p medium, it's running really well. I'm actually surprised to see that we're in the 80 frame per second. Now this is medium. I could be more aggressive with the settings, but again, we've got a lot worse graphics cards coming up. So I think even medium or even just Cyberpunk in general may be a problem later on. But yeah, this is going real great. Although at 1440p, we do start to dip below 60 frames per second. So this is where this higher resolution option starts to push the 3060 pretty hard, but it's still definitely usable here. And then finally, in terms of power draw, we max out at about 170 to 180 watts, which is pretty good considering the performance we're getting. It's not a super efficient graphics card, but it's decent. And with that, it's time to see how the 3060 handles an Unreal Engine 5 based beast of a game, Stalker 2. So here we have compiling shaders the game, and on our 3060, it's defaulting to overall quality of medium, and this is at 1440p, so we want to drop this to 1080p, because like I said, it's an Unreal Engine game, so it's probably going to struggle at native 1080p, but it does default with DLSS on quality, so that is something to bear in mind. Let's see how it runs like this. Okay, this is actually going pretty well. We're in a pretty open environment and we're getting around 70 frames per second. Now, it may just be medium settings and we have DLSS on, but Unreal Engine 5 and upscaling go hand in hand, like, I don't know, Subway and lettuce diarrhea. But it still looks very good. You don't see the upscaling that much, even with all of this like foliage and fine detail and stuff. Yeah, this is impressive. Now, just out of interest, here we're running at 1080p native, and yeah, we've lost a decent amount of frame rate, but again, it's still kind of usable. The game doesn't feel great at this frame rate, but yeah, you can play it like this if you want to. Yeah, it's pretty good. Now, for the previous most popular graphics card, I think our performance is going to start falling off a cliff pretty quickly here. I'm just judging by generation of graphics card. Now, to find out what this graphics card was, I had to use a combination of Wayback Machine, which I tried to use, and then the website was down that day for some reason. And then I found a very useful YouTube video, which kind of plots out kind of GPU hardware survey results for the last like 10 to 15 years. I'll have the video linked down below if you want to have a look, but the previous most popular graphics card was the GTX 1060. And the most impressive part about the GTX 1060 is the duration of its tenure at the top. It was the most popular graphics card, well, twice, but for this stint, it was from November of 2017 to August of 2022. That's almost 5 years, which is insanely long for this industry. However, on paper, when you look at the GTX 1060, especially compared to the 3060, it looks like it's a huge step down in terms of specs. But remember, Nvidia does redefine all of their internal bits and bobs quite regularly, so it may not translate into as big a drop in performance. Now, an interesting tidbit with the GTX 1060, it's another one of those graphics cards where Nvidia pulled a fast one with its naming scheme. There were two versions. The initial was the 6GB GTX 1060, which was the fully fledged core. However, they later, quite controversially, brought out a 3GB version of the GTX 1060, which didn't just see you losing half of your video memory, but they also cut down a little bit of the GPU die, which loses you performance and got a bunch of people very angry, rightly so. But for this video, I had a 6GB version of the GTX 1060 lying around, so we're gonna see how that one performs. Wow, would you look at that? The 1060 is running the crap out of CS2. Now, unfortunately, our temperatures have rocketed to very high, although I think that's a cooler specific issue here. And I'm sure there are 1060 variants that don't have this issue, but it's not at a point where it's gonna diminish our performance yet. And when compared to the 3060, going back in time loses us about 80 frames per second, which is a not really earth-shattering about 30% change. But there is a utilization difference between the two graphics cards. The 1060 is working comparatively harder. But despite this, jumping up to 1440p doesn't squeeze that gap much bigger. So let's see what Doom Eternal has to say about this. Now, unfortunately, the overlay was real wonky with the 1060 in Doom Eternal for some reason. But when looking at the benchmarks, Doom Eternal stretches that gap to a chasm, a trend that holds into 1440p. Now, a quick side note, before starting my testing in Doom Eternal with the little 1060, I did repaste it, but I was still getting the same temperature performance, so that little cooler is just real butt cheeks. Having said that, I think it's important to point out that in none of the testing did I see the core frequency dip on the card, so I think the temperatures are still okay in that regard. And then when moving over to Cyberpunk, this is where our luck starts to run out with the 1060 a bit. Ooh, this is a 1080p. But we do have some Fidelity FX, which if turned up to balanced, gives a pretty big jump in playability. We're almost getting 60 frames per second here, it feels a lot better and it looks fine. But when compared to the 3060 at native 1080p, yeah, the 1060 is kind of starting to struggle here, which doesn't bode well for Stalker. Having said that, I guess it kind of hangs in there at 1440p. But I wouldn't play it like that. Oh, wow, okay, Stalker is pretty brave. It's defaulting us to 1440p here, but then when it comes to graphics, it defaulted us to custom low. So I'm actually gonna go straight to FSR balanced to see how that goes. Whoa, that's actually not going too horribly here. 38 to 40 frames per second isn't amazing for a game like this, but I would say that this is on the bottom edge of fun playable, like usable. It doesn't look amazing. Yeah, the sharpness falls apart like patience for your family 3 days into Christmas holiday, and there's quite a bit of smearing, but honestly, I'm quite impressed with this result. So yeah, like I've said constantly through that testing, the 1060 performed quite a bit better than I was expecting. Now from here on out, the graphics card's tenure at the top of the pile becomes a lot more tenuous, and keeping track of who's at the top of the pile when becomes a bit like keeping track of the French Revolution. Stuff gets a bit screwy here. But from October 2017 to November 2017, the most popular graphics card was the GTX 750 Ti, which on paper is a real shriveled up bit of honeymoon ruiner compared to the GTX 1060. Now, one of the nice things about the GTX 750 Ti is that it's not that hard to keep track of the different versions of it. As far as I could tell from my quite limited research, there's only one die that the GTX 750 Ti would ship with, although you could get it with three different memory capacities. Now for this video, I didn't have a GTX 750 Ti lying around, or at least not one that I could easily find in my dragon pile of tech. But luckily, you can still buy them on Amazon for some reason. So let's have a look at the one I got. We know it's a 750 Ti because somebody wrote it on the box in pen. That's very useful. But yeah, as you can tell, this is a little bit of a dumpster rat variant, but it should still do the job, right? So let's open it up. That's quite a nice cooler. It's like a metal shroud that's got this, I don't know, it's almost like a cherry red paint on it. Yeah, this is a pristine example of a dumpster rat. That's awesome. Oh, wow, we have fallen off a cliff here. That is a huge drop in performance. Although having said that, this is still a playable esports experience, so it could have been worse, especially considering that this graphics card is now just a thing we use for video out, pretty much. Very expensive video out. But there's no getting around it, that's a massive difference in performance. Although what is cool is the 750 Ti really sips power, using way less than the other two GPUs, which also helps explain why it's such an appealing low-profile graphics card. Whereas Doom Eternal first off broke the overlay for some reason, and we see a continental shift in framerate, but it is running at high settings, which I feel like is pretty brutal, and the fact that it's running at all is kind of impressive. Yeah, apparently if all you do isn't play CS2, then you probably don't want to be on this graphics card. It's not going too great here. Now, this is at native 1080p, though. So, we are going to have to do some fidelity FX here because, well, clearly. So we're gonna go performance. That's as low as we can do without dynamic scaling. Ooh, it's looking real rough, but we have now broken the eye can perceive movement barrier, so that's pretty cool. Although another big problem is the temperatures. That cooler may be all sexy and red, but it clearly harkens to its dumpster rat heritage in terms of performance. And again, looking at the straight benchmark comparisons, you can't help but feel bad for the 750 Ti as it gets pantsed by the other two graphics cards. And the fact that Stalker 2 just straight up refused to load a save doesn't help its case much. Ooh, yeah, the 750 Ti really didn't enjoy Stalker. But maybe the next GPU will, because for some reason, the GPU that was most popular before this was a much newer graphics card. It's the GTX 960, which is the most popular graphics card from September of 2017 to October of 2017. So again, a very short tenure. Now, in comparing the specs of the 960 to the 750 Ti, there's a big difference between these two. And as far as I can tell, again, like with the 750 Ti, there's just one GPU die version of the 960, although you could get it in two VRAM capacities. Now for this video, I only had a 2GB GTX 960 available, which is a little bit unfortunate because that's very little video memory. I think a 4GB version would perform better in modern games, but there wasn't a single one available in my local area, so we have to use this 960. And as you'll see soon during the testing, it was not a healthy graphics card. It was just very much on its last legs. Oh, and quick fun fact, the 960 was the last 60 series card from Nvidia to support SLI, which is pretty cool. But the moment I plugged that 960 into my test system, things went terribly wrong. Straight off the bat, the system refused to post several times with the 960 in. And when it did finally post, it told me that the graphics card wasn't supported by my UEFI driver. And after I set the boot mode to UEFI and Legacy, then the system couldn't find my boot drive anymore. So I swapped my SSD into a different M.2 slot, which then worked. After confirming that, the system did post, but was very unstable with this 960 in it. Okay, so now that it's finally running, we are quite a bit better off than with the previous graphics card. This is a lot more playable, although, look at that frame drop. I think that's because of our video memory. You can see we're pegged at just under 2 gigs of utilization. So that's a pretty big shortcoming. And what's interesting is that despite the 960's average being 60 frames per second higher than the 750 Ti, its 1% lows are pretty similar. And it's crashed. Oh no, not the teal screen of death. And after several attempts to restart the system, which felt a little bit like trying to jumpstart a 700-year-old lawnmower, we could play some Doom Eternal. Although, because of our 2 gigs of video memory, the highest settings it would let us use was 1080p low, which even the 750 Ti didn't make us do. Oh wow, yeah, the 2 gigs of video memory is really a problem. Even in Doom Eternal, with its Vulcan well-optimizedness. Although this handicap does allow the GTX 960 to look more impressive than it would have if it was on an even playing field. Oh, and it's crashed again, has it? Okay, well, let's see if we can get it running again for some cyberpunk.
1 hour later.
Wow, the 1060 was a huge jump from the 960. At native 1080p medium, the 960 struggles a lot with cyberpunk, but at least we do have the option for some fidelity FX. So this is with balanced fidelity FX, and you know, it's better, it's an improvement, but it's still, it's not running great. I think if you're super desperate, you can maybe play the game like this, but yeah, this is a huge step down from what the 1060 was capable of doing. But maybe it'll be able to regain some of its dignity with Stalker. And after a couple more crashes, we were able to find out. Oh no, this is not what dignity looks like. This is an ultra performance fidelity FX, and it looks like a pastel painting. Ugh. But in all fairness, it is running, if you could call it that, which is more than the GTX 750 Ti could say. Okay, so going back in time is Netara's a much more powerful graphics card. And funnily enough, that happens now again, because before the GTX 960, the 1060 was the most popular for a little bit, which is interesting. It kind of had its reign broken up in two here, but it was only the most popular from May of 2017 to September of 2017. And then the month before that, the 750 Ti was at the top again. As you can tell, there's a lot of shuffling around here, but it does bring us to the end of the list of graphics cards that we're going to look at in today's video. Let me know if you enjoyed the video, and we'll do another one, like, further back in time. If that's something you're interested in, comment down below. And yeah, thank you for watching. Until the next video, bye-bye.